Good afternoon. It's a great pleasure, as always, to be invited to participate in a Phi Beta Kappa event here at Hofstra University. And it is quite a pleasure to welcome today's guest lecturer, Dr. Philip Kitcher. Dr. Kitcher received his BA from Christ's College, Cambridge, and his PhD from Princeton University, and currently holds the John Dewey Professorship of Philosophy at Columbia University. He's a past president of the American Philosophical Association Pacific Division and a former editor-in-chief of Philosophy of Science. He was the first recipient of the APA's Prometheus Prize in recognition of his contribution to expanding the frontiers of research in philosophy and science. He is a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and has been honored by Columbia with its Lenfest Distinguished Faculty Award and a Distinguished Service to the Columbia College Core Curriculum Award. He has been a fellow at the Wissenschaftskolleg zu Berlin, and in the fall of 2015 was the Daimler Fellow at the American Academy in Berlin. He received the Roman L. Phi Beta Kappa Professorship in Philosophy in 2003 and 2004. His books include Living with Darwin, which won a Lannan Foundation Notable Book Award, Science in a Democratic Society, The Ethical Project, Preludes to Pragmatism, Deaths in Venice, The Cases of Gustav von Aschenbach, and Life After Faith, a new book on climate change, The Seasons Alter, How to Save Our Planet in Six Acts, co-authored with Evelyn Fox Keller, will be published by W.W. Norton in April 2017. When the list of PBK visiting scholars for 2016-2017 was distributed to Hofstra faculty, Professor Kitcher's name immediately began to generate excitement. One philosophy professor wrote, "Philip Kitcher has for more than 35 years helped us grasp relationships between scientific reasoning, scientific knowledge, decision-making, democracy, public policy, psychology, and religion. His most influential work, The Advancement of Science, characterized and defended scientific progress as a fundamentally social project. Science earns its objectivity, he argued, not from the objective attitudes of individual scientists, but from the scientific communities being arranged in ways conducive to progressively acquiring knowledge. Grounded in his more technical philosophical research on the structure of scientific explanations and on patterns of reasoning in genetics, his research on scientific communities has led naturally to more recent work on science and society more generally. Kitcher was an early and influential critic of social applications of E.O. Wilson's sociobiology in his book, Vaulting Ambition, and explored the ethical, political, and legal implications of the future of genetics research in the lives to come. In Science, Truth, and Democracy, he reflected on more broadly on the appropriate role for science and scientists in our contemporary society and political discourse. In this vein, his most recent projects have concerned the relationship between science, religion, and values in a secular society. As he has worked on questions spanning many academic fields, a presentation by Kitcher could be expected to be of interest to students and faculty across disciplines, including all the natural and social sciences, political science, and public policy, religion, and philosophy. And I might add that at the time this lecture was scheduled, none of us knew just how very timely it would be. On a personal note, as a geneticist and evolutionary biologist, I have been aware of Professor Kitcher's work for many, many years. In fact, given that he is a colleague of both an undergraduate and a graduate mentor of mine, it's surprising that it has taken until today for our paths to cross. But I am delighted that he is here to edify us at Hofstra about a really, really pressing group of problems and ones that need both very philosophical and very practical solutions. So please join me in welcoming Professor Philip Kitcher.
Thank you very much for that extremely gracious and generous introduction. And let me also say how delighted I am to be out here at Hofstra. I'm spending this year making several visits around the country as a Phi Beta Kappa visiting scholar. And it's really a wonderful opportunity. It's a wonderful opportunity to interact with faculty and above all with students. And I do hope that some of you who are interested in anything that I might be interested in will come by tomorrow morning and spend some time talking with me. I mean, for me, the interaction one-on-one or one on a few with undergraduates has been really, really illuminating and a real joy of this year of visiting various campuses. So what I want to talk about today is what I think of, and I'm not exaggerating, as the most urgent problem of our time. And it comes, as my title suggests, in six questions. Is it happening? Does it matter? Why should we care about the future anyway? What can we do about it? Who pays? And do we need a new politics? I probably am not going to get to all of these today, but I'm going to try to lead you through the first five, at any rate. The last is even more complicated than the first five. Maybe I'll get to say something about it. But I want to begin with the issue that has held up discussion, not only in the United States, but in much of the English-speaking world for so long. Is there really such a thing as human-caused or anthropogenic climate change? And it's very, very difficult for ordinary citizens to make up their minds about this. Not because the climate science community is divided, but because the way in which the information has flowed to the public has tended to suggest that there really are two sides to this question. That's in part an unfortunate feature of our fragmented media and the way in which that media has tended to take factual and scientific issues and pit two adversarial points of view against one another. And so you may be thinking, how on earth can I, who know very little about me or any of you who are not climate scientists, make up your mind about this issue? And I have a suggestion. The suggestion is that you should start by thinking about the ways in which the knowledge has supposedly been generated, and then go on to think about whether something could possibly have gone wrong with it. So let's begin with some very basic evidence for climate change. Here are a couple of graphs superimposed on one another. And the red graph is a graph of the temperature as it's been measured in the last 150 years or so, and as it's been calculated for longer periods than that. The blue graph is the graph that shows the concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere over the same period. And as you can see, there's a very striking correlation. I'm going to get to what might lie behind that correlation in a moment. But first, you might say, how on earth do I know that these graphs have been properly constructed? If you Google around the internet, you will find alternative graphs. How do I know that this one is the right one? And that's a perfectly reasonable question. So how do you reconstruct the Earth's temperature over, say, the last 1,000 years or 900 years, something like that? Well, of course, you measure it. It can be measured in the more recent period. But of course, we're always talking about an average temperature, and an average can be constructed in different ways, and we don't always have all the measurements that we might need to construct a reasonable average for a particular point in time. And so scientists have to use inferences. They have to be able to move beyond the data that they can actually collect. They have to measure things like tree rings and try to form from tree ring data views about what the Earth's temperature was like centuries ago. And they do that because when trees grow, they, you know, the sizes of the rings correlate with the ambient temperature at the time. Okay, so you might say that seems like a pretty reasonable sort of method. You've got ways of looking at processes that go on in the present, like tree growth, and extending those into the past. You're sort of building on the things you can observe to extrapolate to even quite distant past. How do I know they've done it properly? Well, this is where the fact of an enormous consensus within the climate science community comes about. So once you understand the ways in which this information gets put together, you can ask, well, might they have made a mistake? Might they all be involved in some elaborate conspiracy, a hoax? Probably not authored by the Chinese. I suspect the climate science community is not likely to be driven by some sort of Chinese mafia. Those are perfectly reasonable questions. The dynamics of science comes into play. Some years ago, actually about 30 years ago, I had a conversation with one of the most eminent evolutionary biologists in the world, Ernst Mayr. It was in a Harvard parking lot, and he was about to get into his car. And as he got into his car, he said to me, "You know, Philip, you philosophers tend to think that scientists want the truth. They don't want the truth. They want to be right." And I thought, what on earth is the difference between wanting the truth and wanting to be right? And of course, there's a point there. What scientists want is not just that the truth should somehow emerge from the activities in which they engage. They want to be the guys who actually figured it out. And they want credit for it. And so there is within science a built-in kind of competitiveness in a credit economy to be one of those who's advanced some important truth on some important subject. And that's exactly the sort of thing that keeps science sort of, as it were, honest and objective. If it were the case that there was some serious mistake in this, there would be a wonderful opportunity for all sorts of young climate scientists to expose it. And indeed, in the early days of these kinds of temperature reconstructions and carbon dioxide reconstructions, there were bitter exchanges about whether the data had been measured right and whether the statistics had been done right, and those gradually subsided over the years. By the mid-1980s, it was pretty clear that this was the sort of thing that was going on. And so I want to say, even for those of us who are outsiders can make a reasonable judgment here. For two reasons. First of all, we can understand in general how the scientific work is done. And second, if we think about conspiracy theories or subtle mistake theories, we can realize that either the mistakes are so subtle they've eluded all the scientific community, or they would have been detected by now, and they would have been published by now, and the climate science community wouldn't have reached the remarkable consensus it has. Now, as for extreme skepticism, could this be wrong? Could there be some hidden error? Of course. Within any area of science, that's the case. There could be some as yet undetected error in the molecular genetics we're doing, or in the basic physics that we're doing. Skepticism is always possible. But as a former defense secretary would remind us, when you got a problem, you have to go to work with the best science you have, right? And the best science we have at the moment says, yes, it's happening. And as you can see, it looks like a hockey stick, and the blade of that stick goes up rather fast. Okay, so that's the first question. The second question is a much more difficult one. Does it really matter to us? What actually is going to happen in the future, in human terms? Well, if you go on the internet, you can go to any number of places and you can find various groups making probabilistic predictions about how the temperature is going to rise. Actually, you can go to this nice MIT site, and you can spin the roulette wheels, sort of electronically or virtually, and you can see how the future might evolve. Now notice the no policy option. Under the no policy option, it gives a various ranges for temperature increases on the centigrade or Celsius scale. Virtually nothing. There's a tiny, tiny blue sliver, which you might just be able to see, that keeps the temperature below 3 to 4 degrees Celsius. There's quite a large swath at 4 to 5 degrees, 5 to 6 degrees, a much smaller orange bit at 6 to 7, and a small but horrifying red bit that says greater than 7 degrees. The last time the Earth's temperature was 5 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels was a time when there was no ice anywhere on the planet, and crocodiles and alligators were having a great time quite near both of the poles. It was a completely tropical Earth. With 5 degrees Celsius warming, lots of parts of the Earth would be very difficult for people to survive on. Now, with a policy, and I haven't yet sort of even mentioned the options for what the policy might be, the temperatures are significantly reduced. And those of you who followed the climate summit in Paris in December 2015 will know that the people who agreed at that summit wanted to keep the temperature below 2 degrees Celsius, with many of them hoping to keep it below 1.5 degrees Celsius rise. Notice that even under the policy option, that's not a very large sliver of the roulette wheel. Okay, you might say the temperature goes up. If it goes up 5 degrees, that's very bad, but maybe it won't go 5 degrees by 2100. Maybe it'll only go up 3 degrees or 2.5 degrees. So it doesn't go up 5 degrees by 2100. Does it really matter if it's, say, 2133 or 2189 or 2207 by the time it hits a 5 degree rise? Sometimes I think that people who don't want us to engage in starting to try to reduce the emissions that are responsible for the temperature are like people for whom you know, they know they have to go on a diet to stay healthy. And they say, well, yeah, I could give up all the things I like to eat. Maybe I'll do it in 10 years' time, or 20 years' time, or 40 years' time. But they know they're going to have to do it eventually. And the obvious thing to do is to start now, because the consequences are pretty severe. Some of them you know about. This is Miami. I guess it's Miami Beach in Florida. And on the top left, you see what it's like today. And then after 1 meter of sea rise, quite a lot of it gets inundated with water. And that's the sort of thing that, of course, worries people. But it's only the beginning of what should worry people. We tend to fixate on particular constant effects. We say, oh, the Earth's temperature is going to go up 2 degrees, or the sea level is going to rise 0.75 of a meter, or something like that. But that's really not actually the worrying thing. The worrying thing is not what the way in which the average changes, but the way the whole distribution changes, and especially the high sides of the variation. And so, what you should think about is a range of variations around an average. And as the average shifts, the whole distribution shifts, and you get more things happening at the high extremes. In the case of temperature, that's more extremely hot weather. And it's worse even than that, because the picture I've got up here is a picture that shows the distribution remaining the same. Many people think that for theoretical reasons, for certain climatic phenomena, the distribution itself will be distorted and yield what statisticians call a fat tail. That means that there's more at the extreme end. And if that happens, not only do you get a lot more extreme weather, you get even more extreme extremes. Now, some of this is already present in the data that we have. Extreme events get measured, big storms, heat waves, and so forth. And this is record, it's not particularly up to date, for extreme events in recent decades. And notice how the graph there goes up too. Large storms. Now you have to think not just about large storms, you also have to think in many parts of the world, including in parts of the United States, about periods of extreme drought. You have to start thinking about flooding. You have to start thinking about heat waves. And you have to start thinking about these things not just singly, but in combination with one another. I think it's very easy for some people to think, well, the sea levels will rise gently and people will move away from the coasts and they will build their houses somewhere else and they'll do their farming somewhere else and it'll all be all right. But that's actually not the way it's working already. In certain regions of the world, water is getting short ever more frequently. There are more periods of drought. And as those droughts occur, particular people who want to irrigate their crops divert water sources so that they can grow the food they need. And as that happens, they come into conflict with their neighbors who dislike the fact that their own fields don't get irrigated anymore. And so all sorts of conflicts are already starting to break out. And you can imagine a future in which this increases, in which there are wars about water, in which floods come at some time of the year and overwhelm the sewage systems, in which there are recurrent heat waves. And so the migrants of the future aren't going to be setting out comfortably in their cars with their possessions in tow and going to places where they can find, you know, clean beds and shelter and good food supply. They're going to be dirty. Their hygiene is going to have broken down. They're going to be moving into areas where people are already struggling to make ends meet, people who resent their coming. We've already been seeing in the contemporary world the ways in which the problems of migration play out in the political life of countries. So, what I want to suggest is that when we think about the future, we stop thinking just about the constant effects. The temperature will be greater than it is now. The sea level will be higher than it is now. Think about the episodic effects, the things that happen at the tail ends of the distribution, and think about the ways in which those things combine with one another. Okay. Well, you may say, and quite reasonably, that's all very terrible, but it's in the future. We have plenty of problems in the world today, and we can look around us and see many ways in which that this contemporary world is unjust and many things that we should do. Perhaps we should concentrate on solving those problems, on making the world's economies as strong as they can possibly be, so that when the troubles come in the future, our descendants will be prepared for them and will have resources to deal with them. That, I think, is a quite plausible initial line of reasoning. The only trouble is that if we don't do anything about climate change, it will itself start to affect the economic productivity of major parts of the world. The climate will itself deliver economic shocks So we can't smoothly extrapolate from the economic growth of the last century and a half. Some economists think that we shouldn't do that anyway, that economic growth has actually plateaued. But even supposing that that isn't the case, we can't expect that economic growth itself is going to be untouched by the phenomena of climate change. Moreover, the kinds of effects that climate scientists predict in the next century and the rest of this century are already severe enough that they will tax our ability to solve the sorts of problems that we see around us in the world today. Problems of poverty, problems of inequality, and problems of tensions between groups who are competing over scarce resources. Now, the great climate scientist who first announced the phenomena of anthropogenic climate change to the United States Senate, James Hansen, wrote a book about this called Storms of My Grandchildren. And that's a really appropriate title because it tells us about a particular group of people, people about whom we typically care quite a lot, whose welfare we put at risk if we don't do something about it. And I think Hansen was right to recognize the personal stake that many of us feel in the future, because not only will we leave direct descendants behind, but people we know will leave descendants behind, our country will leave descendants behind, and so on and so forth. And we want those people to be able to have the same kinds of lives that we, or at least those of us who have been relatively fortunate, have enjoyed. But there's a more impartial perspective that we can take here. I want you to imagine something. I want you to imagine that the people of the future come back and talk to us. And they say to us, you neglected this problem completely. You didn't act. You were warned again and again and again that there were these potential dangers. And you left us without any resources for coping with them. You were so concerned with your own local problems that you just didn't take the sometimes painful actions that might have been demanded of you to make the world a safer place for the generations to come. I think it's worth imagining that and imagining what we might respond to them. Now, it seems to me from an ethical point of view that in this conversation there has to be a balance. They would be wrong to demand of us that we completely neglect all of those who are around us in the world today who are suffering, that we put their problems on one side completely and just devote ourselves to climate change. But it would be equally wrong of us to say the problems of the people in the contemporary world are so important that those have to come first and we have to solve those and not worry about these, quote, nebulous future ills that may affect future generations. There has to be a balance here. And in a certain sense, this is the problem that is at the heart, or the ethical problem that is at the heart of our climate policy, our global climate policy. It's the problem of deciding how to apportion the burdens across the generations and across countries. This has been extraordinarily difficult for the nations of the world to work out so far. But we are, in effect, facing a four-sided ethical dilemma. We have four prima facie obligations. Okay, the first of those obligations, and I'll put it first, is to make sure that the Earth remains a habitable place for our descendants. The second is to attend to problems of inequality and injustice and suffering in the contemporary world. The third is to attend to the problems of developing nations, nations that have been left behind in the process of industrialization and that are now caught in the bind of either refraining from development or turning to the same kinds of processes, use of fossil fuels, that have caused our own industrial affluence. And the fourth dilemma is to preserve all of the great things that our species has collectively accomplished over its existence. All the things that we wouldn't want to give up. Our human achievements in political life, in art, in science, in preserving and enhancing the natural environment. So we've got four things that tug at us, and they tug at us from different directions. And those have all, I think, to be acknowledged. That's the ethical dilemma that lies at the heart of the climate situation, as I see it. Now, what actually can be done? Well, many people sort of say the way to do this is for each of us to act as individuals and to switch to a different kind of transportation or to eat different things, or if you're academics, not to go to conferences anymore, but to participate virtually, etc., etc., etc. I think these proposals are all very well. They take us a little way, but they take us nowhere near far enough. This cannot be something that happens individual by individual. It's going to have to happen on a coordinated scale, because the remedies for the problem lie in a substantial and systematic reduction of our emission of greenhouse gases. That's most notable in industry that uses fossil fuels, but it's also in our agricultural practices, which are on some estimates responsible for 10%, on some estimates responsible for 30% of greenhouse gas emissions. Now, when you start to think about this in detail, it's very clear that all sorts of ways in which people are accustomed to moving around and using energy to heat buildings and cool buildings are going to have a radical revisionary rethinking. What's more, this is going to have to be done by states and within states that are currently competing in a global economy. And this raises a really serious and quite deep economic problem. The economic problem is simply that in a state of a competitive global market, if one nation starts to take the kinds of measures that are needed to make this transition go through in a systematic and timely fashion, that nation looks as though it's going to put its own economic development and well-being at risk. So this problem has been worked over and thought about by eminent economists over the last 20 to 30 years. One solution to it, and I think it's a pretty good solution as far as it goes, is what the economist William Nordhaus calls a climate club. A bunch of nations get together and they form a climate club. They agree on various targets for reducing their emissions and try to coordinate their efforts. And they trade freely among one another, but they put a carbon tax on all the imports that come from nations that don't, as it were, participate in this. This is the sort of thing that would, in theory at any rate, work quite well for the developed countries. I'll come to the countries that want to develop in a moment. Now, it seems to me that we cannot, as with so many economic forecasts, simply remain in the realm of theory and hope that all will work out. Economic theory, like climate science, is dealing with a very, very complex system or set of systems. And there's always an issue about how the theoretical models that climate scientists and economists put forward play out in the real world. And so I'm going to recommend a pragmatic stance with respect to the problem of approaching climate change. What we need is radical amounts of experimentation. Climate clubs need to form and they need to experiment. They need to figure out what kinds of things work, not only in terms of reducing the emissions in a timely fashion, but also the kinds of things that work in the sense that people can live with them, right? So you've got, as it were, two notions of working here. The emissions have to be reduced, and at the same time, the people who live in the countries that are reducing their emissions have to find ways of reorganizing their lives in satisfactory ways. I don't think we know how, in advance, how this can be done, and I don't think any social scientist can tell us. It's got to be experimental. So I'll give you a figure, a metaphor from William James, one of my favorite philosophers. Sometimes he puts it in terms of people lost in a blizzard on a mountain pass. Sometimes he puts it in terms of people lost in a dark wood. You're in a place which is very dangerous, and you can't have theoretical or planned knowledge of how to get out of it. So what do? You look for light between the trees or possible places off the snowy mountain, and you try it out. And you constantly monitor what you're doing, and you try to adjust your actions and find your way to safety. That, I think, is our predicament. And I don't think we can do better than to experiment on a global scale with various measures for mitigating and adapting to climate change. But we are actually better off. We're better off than a single individual or even a group of individuals lost in a wood or caught on a mountain pass. And the reason for that is that we can try lots of different experiments in lots of different places and see what works, and we can instantly communicate the results to one another and latch on to the good ones, okay? But to do that will require a vast amount of international cooperation, which is, of course, the last of my questions. Do we need a new politics and a new economics? I don't think we can plan decisively for reducing emissions fast enough in ways that would be socially and economically manageable. We have to try various things and see what works. Now, I've left the developing countries out of this, and they pose a further problem. And this is my fifth question, the question of who pays. So here are some recent data on comparative emissions trends. And you'll see that China is currently the world's emission leader, going up and up and up. And the United States is tapering off, very slowly, but tapering off. And in the middle is India, which is coming up fast. And I want you to think about the plight of countries like India and Indonesia and most of Africa and most of South America and quite a lot of Central Asia too. Okay, these are countries that have been left behind by the Industrial Revolution. One thing they don't have typically is reliable electricity. And if there's one thing that makes, as it were, life in the affluent world different from life in the as yet undeveloped world, it's the absence or presence of a regular supply of electricity. The Indian government reluctantly signed on to the December 2015 accord in Paris. But before then, Prime Minister Modi had been talking for quite a long time about using the coal that India sits on, to fuel electricity. Modi pledged to provide for Indians a regular supply of electricity. It's a huge undertaking. And the obvious solution, if climate change were not a problem, would be to use the coal that they have. Neighboring Bangladesh, which is on the front lines of climate change because its coastline inhabited by several hundred thousand people, is likely to be inundated in the next decades. And yet Bangladesh decided to build on the edges of its last remaining Aboriginal forests, coal-fired electrical power plants. The need for electricity is so great in these parts of the world. And so even if China peaks in 2030, India won't peak then, and Indonesia will peak after that, and Brazil and lots of Africa, unless, of course, they forgo development entirely. Of course, they could develop. They could develop, as one hopes, the affluent world will go, namely on the basis of renewable sources of energy, solar power, wind power, hydroelectric power, geothermal power, and possibly as a last resort, nuclear power. But who will pay for that? Again and again and again, the developing nations, and this has been one of the great stumbling blocks to progress on climate change, have said, you owe us. You owe us the aid to pay. And again and again and again, even as enlightened an administration as the Obama administration has said this, we cannot pay the amounts that you are asking for. But again, here there's another ethical question that arises. Do we have an obligation to help the non-developing parts of the world to develop? I think there's a very good argument for thinking that we do, and I'm going to show you a table. Whoops. There we go. I don't think you can read that, so I'm going to have to read it to you. So I've given you, there are four countries here. The United States on top row, the United Kingdom, second row, Germany, third row, China, fourth row. And in the adjacent column, there are figures for the number of tons of greenhouse gases that these countries have emitted. The United States, 3.4 times 10 to the 11th. This was up to about, I think, 2010, I'm not sure. The United Kingdom, 6.9 times 10 to the 10th, and so on. Now, you might think of our atmosphere as a reservoir into which you can pour so much greenhouse gas before it gets dangerous. And if you think, the size of that reservoir is going to depend on the concentration of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere that you think is the maximum you can allow. At the moment, we're around 400 parts per million. People used to think it was dangerous to get to 400 parts per million. Some people still think it's dangerous to get to 400 parts per million, but others are saying we have to tolerate 450 parts per million. So I set the size of the reservoir at 450 parts per million. Okay, now, ask how much of that reservoir space the United States has already used. 31%, just us, already. The United Kingdom, 6%, Germany, 8%, China, 10%. Now, you might say that your share of that reservoir should be apportioned by your share of the global population. We'll be generous to the United States over this period and take the relatively high value of 4%. I mean, we weren't 4% of the global population when we started industrializing. And then we can have what I've called in the last column, the per capita multiplier. That's the number of times the value of our fair share that we've actually used. So in the United States, it's almost 8 by 2010. For the United Kingdom, it's 6.8. For Germany, it's 7.0. For China, so far, it's 0.5. And in fact, the Chinese may get away underneath their fair share. If their projections go through, the Chinese will be the good guys. They will be the ones who have actually used no more than their fair share of the atmosphere. So you might say, we've overused. And because we've overused, there isn't enough to spare for the Indians and the Indonesians and the Brazilians and the Mexicans and all the countries of Africa. And therefore, we owe it to those countries to foster their development using green energy. We owe them aid. And I think that's right. I think we do. I think they have justice on their side. And to tell you the truth, I think that this is not a complicated point to see. In fact, I think it's so simple that unless we accede to it, then international cooperation on climate matters will be permanently blocked. I mean, it's one thing. Sometimes you can get away with injustices in politics, but it requires you to be able to hide them. This one is rather difficult to hide, I think. And so when people say to me, you know, this isn't moral philosophy, this is real politics, I say, well, actually, real politics means recognizing the kinds of injustices that people can see very clearly. Because unless you use force, then people are not going to lie down under conditions that they regard as fundamentally unjust. And that's why, if I had more time, I'd talk about the new politics that we need. Because there is a way to solve the climate problem. It's a real problem, it's a serious problem, it will affect our descendants. There are people young enough in this room whose lives will be affected by it. Not in an apocalyptic way, I don't think, but in a much lower key way. So I'm going to invite you to think again about the future, and those of you who are students here to think about the time when you're in your 70s and 80s. And I don't think that it's going to be a time at which, you're gasping for air or you're worried on a daily basis about clean water, or even that the food supply is disrupted. But I suspect there will be occasions in your lives when either you or people that you care about are shocked by sudden floods or sudden heat waves or sudden storms. I expect there will be times when the cellular service or whatever its equivalent is breaks down and you can't find out whether your loved ones are safe. I suspect that there will be times when, as you feel the pains of old age, drugs are not readily available because drug production has been halted and because people have been hoarding. I expect there will be times when the water turns brown and when you wonder whether it's safe to wash in it. I think that's something that you will experience. There are ways of averting this. We can do something about it. It's not impossible. We are like people caught in a dark wood or people caught on a snowy mountain pass. And what we are going to have to do is learn to cooperate on a global scale and find our way by trying out various options. Some of the things that will happen will dislocate people's lives. And because of that, there are going to have to be more social measures, more safety nets, and more cooperation. And there are also probably going to have to be sacrifices. And I'm going to stop with my philosopher's hat on by saying that the fundamental questions here aren't questions about GDP or rates of unemployment. The fundamental questions are about what it will make for our descendants and for us to live satisfactory, worthwhile, rewarding lives. We have to think about the things that are going to really matter, because my sense is that we are preoccupied far too much in these debates We're thinking about things that in the end don't matter, that are not so fundamental to us. And we should be thinking about the things that really are at the core of our lives and make them go well. What I'm saying is actually not that different from what has been said by other people, people who have very different views from me. Pope Francis, for example, the Dalai Lama, for another. The fundamental questions here are how to solve a really deep and hard, four-sided ethical dilemma, how to construct the framework we need for the pragmatic experimentation that might get us out of this mess, and finally, how to cooperate and learn how to live with the things that really matter to us. I don't think it's impossible, but I do think it's enormously difficult. Thank you very much. So did you get to ask questions? I would love to have you ask questions about, I mean, there's lots more to say.
So if you have questions, just come up to the microphone, please, because they're recording, so it will look better.
How you doing? Thanks for coming. My question is, you hear sometimes like a point of no return, and I was wondering if that's even like a real thing, because I watched the Leonardo DiCaprio documentary not too long ago, and I feel like there was a mentioning of a point of no return, or I've read before that we've passed, with the many people on this earth, we passed our ability to have resources that are going to continue to renew every year. We've passed that point. I was just wondering if there's any legitimacy to that.
Okay, so look, it's not the case that that... It's an all or nothing affair, right? There are some really gloomy predictions about human extinction that some people have toyed with. And perhaps those have some probability. Nobody can know how much. But I don't think we're yet doomed to extinction. The question is how much suffering are future human beings doomed to experience. And there are things that people call tipping points. If, for example, not only the Greenland ice sheet melts, but the Antarctic ice sheet melts, the consequences for coastal regions are going to be quite extraordinary. If the temperature goes up 5 degrees above pre-industrial levels, then you won't be able to work in large parts of the world where billions of people now live. One thing I didn't say, which comes out of your question and is completely right to mention in your question, is that all climate policy has to involve a population component. I'm one of those people who think that the way out of the population explosion is through education, particularly female education. Since in countries where the girls get educated, there's a tendency to follow the same pattern, the so-called demographic transition that's been, clear. Sorry, that's my phone. Sorry about that. So the demographic transition has occurred in Europe and birth rates fall and so on and so forth. The thought is that has happened in some states in the developing world, states where female education has been made a big priority. So I do think population policy is important, but rather than thinking in terms of points, at the point at which the human future just gets basically completely impossible, I think you should think about several points that at which there are dramatic changes in the consequences, and We may well have passed some of these points already, so we may be locked into certain levels of pain and suffering for our descendants, but there are many more that we could try to avoid. And the climate activists like me tend to want us to avoid as many of them as possible. Yeah.
Hi. So I have a question. I'm going to try to be as politically correct as I can be, but please forgive me if I offend anybody. I'm not trying to. But listening to your presentation, there's an aspect of it that, you know, we have to look at. We have a president-elect that basically said that, you know, climate change is a hoax. So with like looking at that and the fact that we need policies that will help the future, do you think that if he doesn't change his stance, how will that affect, you know, the general consensus of China, you know, combat climate change and trying to get it under control?
Yeah, terrific. Haven't we all been thinking about it? Those of us who worry about climate change, haven't we all been thinking about this since November the 8th? So there are many points of view in people who think about climate change. Some say it's an absolute disaster. This means that the agreement in Paris, which looked like such a bright moment, all the nations of the world come together, we set targets, insufficient targets. Really, that has to be acknowledged. The Paris targets are nowhere near enough. That was a good start, at least there was a beginning, at least the United States was on board, at least the United States was actually working with China and things were going, and trying to persuade India, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. That's all gone, it's gonna be disaster, there's no way back. That's the really pessimistic view. The really optimistic view is, well, the United States cops out or tries to cop out, but now China steps up. China takes over as the world leader. It actually, the Chinese see this as their opportunity to emerge onto the world political stage as really the good guys and the guys who are going to do great things for the future of humanity and for civilization. That's the extremely optimistic view, I think. I suspect that my answer is going to be a bit like my answer to the last question, the first question. You know, this is a matter of degree. I'm pretty sure that this is going to get in the way, interfere with the kind of action that's urgently needed, but how much, I think, is not clear. There's always the possibility that our president-elect will be more open to thinking about this. I mean, I sometimes think that his opinions on some issues are not exactly formed through a very long interval of very profound reflection. So there's a chance, right, that are pretty shallowly held, and that he might change his mind and that somebody might convince him. You know, maybe I should send him a copy of the book. It's a thought, isn't it? But I mean, I don't think we can bank on that. I think, the strategy of the book that Evelyn Fox Keller and I have written, it's an unusual book. I want to say a little bit of something about it. We actually think that the time has come for a new kind of discussion, that what is needed in the here and now to get this movement to go forward in our country and elsewhere is not for people any longer to tune into the internet sites and the TV, but to sit down and start talking to one another, and especially the people who disagree with them. There's got to be conversation. And so we've actually written the book as a series of dialogues between two characters. There's a guy called Joe with an E, who is a nice guy, sympathetic guy, but he's really not on board with climate change. And He takes each of the six questions I outlined here, and he takes the foot dragging side of it. Right? It's not happening. Doesn't really matter. We don't have to care about the future. There's not much we can do anyway, etc., etc. His partner is Joe without an E, who's female and climate activist, and they occur in different dialogues. They're from different countries and they're different ages and they have different relationships to one another. And we use this to try to model the ways in which you might try to talk through these issues. And then we supply a whole bunch of references and notes at the end for conversation. Now, this is actually my co-author, Evelyn Fox Keller, was very active in the 1960s in the movement against the Vietnam War. And she said to me one day, what we need is Vietnam summer all over again. When people sat down and they talked to one another, they worked these things through. This happened in the early days of biotechnology with movements in places that had laboratories where people were worried about, bad bugs escaping and recombinant DNA research sort of creating Frankensteinian monsters and all the rest of it. It happened with the AIDS crisis. And we hope that maybe this sort of thing can happen again, that we can start conversations on the ground, grassroots conversations, universities, schools, PDA meetings, churches, mosques, synagogues, workplace cafeterias, bars, pubs, places people hang out together, in the hope that people will talk their way through it and start actually working for serious effort. Now, if that happened, then even with a recalcitrant president in the White House, there might be sufficient pressure from below to get climate change policy moving. Look, I don't think that any of the things I've said to you today, with the exception of what I said at the very beginning about the reality of climate change, is by any means the last word on the subject. The point is that we have to go on from this, the situation where we've sort of mapped it out, and try to make the dialogue more sophisticated and try to work through the issues and try to find a way. That's really the message of our sort of program, insofar as it's a program. Have I stunned you all into silence?
Yes.
Please, raise your doubts, especially.
But I won't use the microphone. I'll just project. So in an administration that denies climate change, from a national security standpoint, do you think it could just be an excuse to be more isolationist on a global stage by taking away a legitimate reason for conflict? Or do you think it could be something else?
Well, I think actually the president will quickly learn that the Pentagon is really worried about this particular issue, and that may change his mind. I think, our armed forces have been extreme. I mean, the chiefs of our armed forces have been very much aware of this and have been very worried about the defense of the United States on climatic grounds. I mean, there's an interesting book that's been written on the subject of climate wars, and it seems to me quite likely that within the next 30, 40 years, wars will break out in various regions because of climate change, what climate change has done to the ways of subsistence of those people. I mean, some people are already saying that this has been a factor in conflicts in the Middle East, for example. Yeah. So, I don't know what exactly the foreign policy of the future will be, and how this administration will react as it gets briefed in various ways. Yeah. Do you want to speak from where you are?
Yeah.
Okay. I think if the microphone is inhibiting people from speaking, I would rather have people speak. Yeah.
Sure. So my question is, now, if the all this optimism about our president-elect being, he can change his mind, but what if he is really hard-headed on his stance of climate change? Do you see, how much of the Obama administration's work towards climate change is in danger? Are we now in a period of acceleration towards the coastal flooding pictures that you showed in our presentation?
Yeah. I mean, it'll get worse. There's no question about that if he doesn't change his mind. It'll get worse because our emissions will go up. I mean, Let's go back a slide or two, if I can find arrow keys. Sorry, that was the one I wanted. So there you've got the United States emissions tapering off. I mean, if Trump really wants to, you know, in Sarah Palin's words, drill, baby, drill, and mine and all the other things, then our emissions are going to go up again. So we are going to be basically doing more damage to the atmosphere. There is a serious question about what the status of the agreement in Paris is. So that's an agreement, I gather, within a framework convention that was accepted by a number of nations back in the early 1990s. Somebody who knows the law might know more about this than I do. But it's not obvious that you can simply withdraw from the Paris Accord without withdrawing from that framework convention. And that would be a huge international step. And various foreign policy advisors might well suggest that that's too big a step for the United States to take. Certainly the things that need to be done will only be done accidentally, if at all. So suppose we think about the infrastructure plan that that the president-elect seems to want to have, although, I mean, we don't know any details about this yet. I mean, that infrastructural plan probably shouldn't build super big highways so that people can drive in their one at a time in cars around congested cities. It probably should rebuild the rail system of the country. We probably should start decreasing the amount of flying that we do. So possibly not building fancy new airports is a good idea. So, I mean, it depends. It really, but it may be that some of the infrastructure stuff that he wants to do is actually helpful. I mean, but it probably won't be helpful because he wants to solve that problem. I think the American future, even over the course of a Trump presidency and its impact on climate change, is likely bad. But how bad, I think, is at this point radically unclear. Yeah. Yes.
I actually really like the first section.
I was thinking about the way you handled the first question, because it's in our little professional philosophy community, this is sort of central. This is what we do, is we talk about epistemology. Yeah. And it has been worrying me, particularly over the last couple, 3 weeks, about the degree to which our confidence in epistemology has just dropped through the floor. And so my personal practical pedagogical problem right now is like, what do I do about that? I thought I've been teaching this kind of stuff for years and years and years, and it seems like I really need to do more. But then I feel this sort of tsunami of public media stuff that's social media stuff that's just sort of obliterating the very idea of getting it right.
So this is a huge problem, and it's come up in general. It's been those of us who have been really interested in climate change and the ways in which the climate change message doesn't get out have been thinking about this for a very long time, but it now seems to have emerged as a very general problem. What happens in a democracy when the citizenry is really badly informed, when people don't have access to the best available information? So Plato had this really sort of dark view of democracy. He says, look, Democrats always say, democracy is great because it gives you freedom. But actually the freedom is spurious because people are so stupid. Most people are so stupid that they don't know what's good for them. And so if you leave the choices to them, they'll choose badly and it'll be disastrous. So Plato thinks that what you need is a special class of really wise people, philosophers who have natural talent. They are golden people, and they get this 50-year education, which culminates with exposure to something so wonderful, namely the form of the good, that they are not only wise but also completely incorruptible from that point on. It's a lovely story, but of course a fantasy. Now, Plato would actually be, Plato is completely wrong because people are not stupid. But the dangers to democracy are just as great if people are systematically misled, if they're systematically misinformed about their interests. Because then they may actually vote in ways that they think of as advancing what they really want, but in fact be operating directly counter to their interests. Now, I don't know that that has happened in this election. I think anybody who lives in New York should be very, very careful about saying that this election represents a bunch of people who have perfectly reasonable goals and have somehow been misled and don't know what's good for them, right? But it's certainly the case that in the climate change case, and in other cases probably true too, many people don't know things which the expert community would say, it is now known, right? It's now known that this, right? And it's not known by the people, and that's really harmful for them in their daily lives and in their electoral choices. This has come about because, of course, of the fragmentation of the media. And you can see, I've watched this happening over the last decades, the ways in which basically, media outlets, television, radio, internet sites, latch on to the thought that they're going to cater to a particular niche, right? It's a nice sort of ecological principle. I'll find my niche and I'll cater to that niche and then I'll be just fine. And the result has been to present various news items in ways that will keep the viewers or the clickers or the hearers happy. So, from time to time, unfortunately, disturbing bits of information come along. And then what do you do? Three major strategies. Bury it or ignore it altogether. Okay? That's a strategy that's pursued by, I think, actually media outlets across the political spectrum. Pair it with something which is completely unrelated, but that enables the people who are listening or watching to sort of, as it were, take a sugar-coated pill. The last strategy, which I think is absolutely masterly when Fox News does it, I mean, they're really brilliant at it, is to present the information in such a flat and gray and neutral and affectless tone that the reader will sort of glaze over while reading it, and even if it's absorbed at all, it won't really sink in. I think Fox is rhetorically very good. I think they have some very clever writers for them. And this is, as it were, the strategy of last resort for them. Now, when this happens, basically the ideal of free speech in a democracy tends to break down, and you get people who are unable to make up their minds on the basis of the public debate. And that's why Evelyn and I decided that we needed something different, something like a grassroots, private, small conversations model for going on with this. I don't know whether that will make any difference at all. I do know one thing, though, and that is that I've just been invited to do this, and the Chronicle of Higher Education is actually going to publish a special issue of its review, the Review Chronicle, the Chronicle Review, on issues, on this exact epistemological issue, what happens when people can no longer figure out the facts, when we live in a so-called post-truth world. I haven't made up my mind whether I'm going to write just about climate change or about other things too. But at the moment, it seems to have surfaced as a general problem, and we're rightly worried about it. And the solution that we can't do is, as it were, you know, resurrect Walter Cronkite and have him say, and that's the way it is, as he used to say at the end. But those of you who are students are too young to remember Uncle Walter. So the CBS Evening News always ended with Walter Cronkite saying, and that's the way it is, Thursday, December the 1st, 2016, right? And everybody believed that that was the way it was because he was, you know, the pillar of integrity. You can't do that. Once you've lost this sort of the trust in media sources, any attempt to sort of say, well, now we've got a medium that really does it right, is going to look to people like Pravda, your the organs of the press, whatever. So it doesn't fly anymore. So how we get back, I don't know. Yeah.
You mentioned that your co-author is a climate activist and just wondered if you...
Well, she's a very, very distinguished scholar, feminist scholar in science studies.
I just wondered if you had some ideas that you could share with us of organizations or groups that you think are really doing good work that students who are interested might learn about and become involved in.
Yeah, there are lots of individual groups. I mean, there is one group that I actually just learned about that's trying to get climate media onto local television stations that basically have, you know, 8 hours of sort of, lots of local TV stations that have 8 hours of stuff that really attracts viewers and lots of filler, right? And the thought is to get them to donate some of that filler time to sort of climate messages and showing films and stuff like that. I actually think that there are other people who say that, I mean, other climate activist organizations that say, look, the way to do this is to go to local groups and go to the local concerns, like, In a particular region, certain kinds of crops are dying out, or animals are dying out. You know, go and put the message in those terms. Now, I can't off the top of my head give you names, but it seems to me that these kinds of local efforts are multiplying, and there are quite a lot of them. Yeah. If you email me, I'll try to find some good ones. Okay, good. Yeah.
One of the more popular sentiments that's been expressed on social media recently came from a speech that Edward Snowden gave at a tech conference in Oakland. He gave via video about how government officials and governments are locked in ideological conflicts that are so intractable that they can't really find coherent policy solutions, and that it's up to technological innovation and private companies to sort of abet government processes in terms of answering these questions. So I wondered if you thought there was any role that private corporations could play in the long-term reduction of emissions.
Yeah, okay, so that's very good. There's a movement, and I'm blanking on the name, that tries to solve the developing world problem in this way. That basically says, what we need to do is broker some deals between corporations in the affluent world and development projects in the as yet undeveloped world. Set those up in such a way that there's some profit in it from the developers, the affluent companies' point of view. That's being tried. It's not enormously successful. And it's also, I have to say, viewed by many people who are in the developing countries as a moral mistake. That, in effect, what you're asking for is, after you've taken all the share, you know, far more than your share of a global resource, you're then saying, well, you know, we'll work it out so that you can do it, but only if we can make some profits out of it. And there's something almost obscene about that from the point, but it may be the best one can do. In general, people who are doing policy, insofar as there's a really sort of strong policy push, it tends to be dominated by the thought that you've got to work through market mechanisms. Evelyn and I tend to think that, along with Naomi Klein in her book, This Changes Everything, well, that's a mistake, that you can't actually get market mechanisms of the sort that we currently have to do the kinds of things that are needed. What you've got to do is what economists would call adjusting the incentives. And part of the adjusting of the incentives has got to be involve aid packages and safety nets and all sorts of other things that free marketeers in general resist. I mean, this is the last and big push. I mean, I didn't even go there. I mean, I led you up, as it were, to the, you know, through five questions, but I didn't take you to number six, which is, I think, the really very, very hard one, to how you integrate this into the sort of global economy we have now and the extreme cutthroat capitalism, which is currently on the economic and political stage. That's difficult. Your suggestions are to work with it, and I'm in favor of doing that insofar as one can. We should use all the tools, but there are certain aspects of this problem that I think defy market-based solutions with the sorts of economic incentives that currently exist. It's a very good question.
I'd like to thank Professor Kitcher so much for your talk.